This lecture is going to be a pretty quick look at sequences in a metric space. If you're watching this, I assume that you've already really studied sequences of, say, real numbers, maybe in first semester real analysis. So I'm going to be pretty fast and casual as we go through a lot of results in this video, because the ideas that you already probably have formed about sequential convergence on R translate pretty natural in general, including the definition of a convergent sequence right here. I'll point out a couple things that are different. And then we will talk a little bit more about sequences in the next few videos. So take a moment, if you haven't had a chance yet, to pause and read this definition of sequential convergence. Okay, let me point out some of the main aspects to this definition. We are working in a general metric space, and that's it. We don't know that we're in a vector space or something like that. We're just in a metric space, but that's all you really need to describe sequential convergence, because the idea of a sequence trending towards a limit is the idea of distances shrinking to zero. In a metric space, we have a notion of distance. Just a remark about my notation here. I'm pretty casual when it comes to sequence notation. So here I'm just saying x sub k. Sometimes I might put that in parentheses or curly brackets. I rely a bit on context for the reader to understand when I'm talking about the entire sequence versus when I'm highlighting individual terms. And then here you can see in this particular write-up, I chose to put everything in curly brackets. That's usually what I do. But sometimes, and in other text or resources, you might see sequences in parentheses, which is also fine. Sometimes people don't like curly brackets because it looks like a set and a sequence is an ordered list. But this is just like what I do. So hopefully the notation is not too bad. All of the terms of the sequence belong to the metric space. That will be important when we talk about completeness, not in this video, in a future video. And then our notion of sequential convergence doesn't immediately sound like what you would have called sequential convergence on the Euclidean real number line, but it's communicating the same idea of trending to a limit, and I will doubly communicate that in just a moment. Let me sketch a picture for now. So say you have a sequence of points, hopefully you can see these points, and we're in the metric space, which is basically my board here. And I want to say that the sequence is tending to this limit here. In real analysis one, you always phrase this, or probably always phrase it in terms of epsilons and choosing an index capital N, which we do have here, to go with the value of epsilon. That's missing from this definition, but I'll reintroduce it in just a moment. We're just saying that for any open neighborhood of what we want to call the limit, there's a threshold index capital N beyond which all of the terms in your sequence land in that open neighborhood. You can start to connect that to perhaps the more traditional definition of sequential convergence that you may have already seen. But like if I, you know, pick this to be my open neighborhood U, it's a little lopsided. Okay, this index landed inside of U, but this one didn't. So this is not a good threshold. But at this point, all of the terms after that stay inside of U. So that looks good. But the idea is I could shrink U, I could get ever smaller with my open neighborhoods. So that, you know, if I insist that the open neighborhood containing the limit is not very large, to say that all of the points in the sequence land in that neighborhood beyond a certain threshold is to communicate the idea of the sequence getting nearer and nearer to this limit. Okay, let me step aside for just a moment, and then I will come back and basically just retranslate this description in terms of epsilon. It's not going to be surprising what it looks like. Here we have a restatement of the definition of sequential convergence for a metric space, and this might sound a little bit more familiar or more similar to your definition of convergence on the real number line. So we're saying that the definition we just covered, the idea that the sequence xk has a limit of x, is equivalent to the idea that for any positive number epsilon, there's a threshold index capital N beyond which all sequential terms are within distance epsilon of the limit. So this is really a restatement, but since we already have a definition, we should prove that this is equivalent. I'm just going to give you an outline of the proof. I might omit a sentence or two. So proof outline, because it really is so much of a restatement. It's not really a new concept here. Okay, the outline for the forwards direction. Suppose we know that the sequence xk has a limit of x. Then for any open U, there's a threshold index beyond which all terms are within that neighborhood U. Just take the neighborhood U to be the epsilon neighborhood around X and you're done. So again, this is kind of an outline or a casual proof. Take U equal to the epsilon neighborhood around X in the definition. Okay. And I'll do dot, 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 because if I were writing this formally, I might say a little bit more. See if you can go the other direction just as casually. Going the other direction, I would like to say that if this right-hand side is true, that means that we have the definition of sequential convergence as it was stated a moment ago in terms of open sets U. For that, you just have to realize that, hey, if you're in an epsilon neighborhood, that's like basically good enough, because if I want to insist that points land inside of, say, this large neighborhood U, just take a subset of it, which is an epsilon neighborhood. Being in the subset of U is being in U. Okay, I said it all out loud, so let me write it down. Going backwards, conversely. For any U, for any open U containing X, so for any open U containing X, choose epsilon greater than zero, so that the epsilon neighborhood around X is a subset of U, possible because U is open. Now we know that we can land in this neighborhood because we're assuming the right-hand side is true, that lands us in U. So again, I'm dot, dot, dotting the rest of the proof, but hopefully you can make the connection between these two kind of variations of what it means to say that a sequence converges. One thing I like about this characterization is that it emphasizes the notion of distance. So as a corollary to this, we could say, well, it's not corollary to a definition is sort of a funny idea, but basically, if a sequence is converging, then the distance from the sequence terms to the limit is going to zero. That's not surprising, but it's probably worth stating explicitly because, you know, we can shrink the distances arbitrarily small. So we know that the distance from our sequence terms to zero, to the limit goes to zero. Okay, let me give you a moment to digest this and then we'll continue. I have here three exercises or like thought experiments for you to pause and work through on your own. So first, suppose our metric space is the set of markers, so these four markers, together with the discrete metric. Experiment with this idea. What would it look like to say a sequence in that metric space converges? What would have to be true about the sequence? And then I just want you to think through these ideas. Does it mean anything to say the sequence is monotone in this metric space? So on R, when you studied sequences of real numbers, you talked about things like monotone sequences, bounded sequences, increasing, decreasing sequences, right? So think about those notions in this metric space. What would it mean to say a sequence is monotone? What would it mean to say a sequence is bounded? And I will come back and talk through my answers for these questions. If you want to claim that a sequence converges to a limit, then you want to imagine that in the infinite tail of the sequence, the terms are really close to the limit. The only way to be close in a discrete metric space is to be the limit itself, right? So if the limit of a sequence is pink marker, and I've got green, orange, and yellow, then if these appear at any point in the sequence, then the distance between the sequence term and the limit is one. That means that beyond some threshold, I shouldn't see these markers anymore. If I kept seeing them as I look at the sequence on and on and on, there would be no suitable threshold to pick. So I have a two-word description for this. Any sequence which converges in a discrete metric space must be eventually constant. And then the limit is whatever term is being repeated. Then the other questions I wanted you to think about were, when is it sensible to say that a sequence is monotone or bounded? For monotonicity, if you want to say that a sequence is increasing or decreasing, there has to be a way to order the terms. That comes naturally on R, but it's not even natural on R2. So if you can find some way to order the terms in your sequence, you could say that your sequence is monotone. But since that's not immediate in most metric spaces. I'm just going to not even talk about monotone sequences in general. So I'll think of this as a concept for, say, sequences of real numbers. Boundedness, however, is more natural, and that's because in a metric space, we have a notion of distance, and being bounded is like saying you're not too far from a certain fixed point. So I'm actually going to give you now, on the next slide, the actual definition of boundedness, and then we'll work through a result. Working in a general metric space, a sequence is bounded if there exists what I like to think of as an anchor point, x naught, x sub zero, so that when you measure the distances from terms in the sequence to this point, those distances are bounded above here by the number capital B. If you think about boundedness of sequences of real numbers, you're just measuring off of the origin. You're measuring off of zero. So here we're saying just measure off of this point instead. Turns out you don't have to really go looking for this point. Any point in the metric space would do, but I'll let you prove that. So this idea that there exists such a point actually isn't really that mysterious. Any point would work. Okay, so we have a result here, which is very similar to a statement that you probably proved in first semester real analysis, which is that convergent sequences are bounded. The proof actually is basically the same, except we're going to work in a general metric space where I am going to, as my anchor point, choose the limit of the sequence. Okay, so this is going to be a direct proof. Suppose that the sequence x sub k converges to x, then meaning as a consequence of the sequential convergence, there exists a threshold index capital N from the set of natural numbers, so that for all indices k at or beyond that threshold, the distance from x sub k to the limit x is less than 1. That might have surprised you what I just wrote. We know the sequence converges. So for any choice of positive number epsilon, I could find a threshold, et cetera, et cetera. Here I'm saying, since we know it converges, choose epsilon to just be the number 1. This is enough. So given like this specific choice of epsilon, N is the corresponding threshold beyond which all of the terms in the sequence are within distance 1 of the limit. Okay, so at this moment, we're like, the infinite tail of our sequence is bounded according to this definition of boundedness, where here, this is playing the role of x sub 0 from the definition. I just have to manually consider the first, say, N minus 1 terms in the sequence, and we literally do it manually. Let capital B be a set maximum. So it's the maximum of a finite set of distances, the distance from the first term to the limit, the distance from the second term to the limit, all the way through whatever this threshold is, about the term before that. And then also 1. Because that's going to cover all of the distances at and beyond the threshold. Okay, so B is at least 1, which means that the infinite tail of the sequence is bounded above by B, but also the distance from the first element to the limit is bounded above by B, so is the second one, et cetera. It's literally by construction. So by construction, we specifically created B to work. So the distance from x sub k to x is less than or equal to B for all indices k. Okay, everything we've done so far was in a general metric space, and to me that's the most interesting. But I would like to take a moment to talk about sequences in Rn. All right, we are basically done introducing sequences. I just want to say a couple quick remarks about sequences of vectors. So imagine you have a sequence in Rn. You can think of that as like a sequence of vectors. Be careful if you're writing these down because there are a lot of indices. You have n is the dimension of the space. You might be indexing the terms in the sequence by k. And then you also have coordinates, like coordinate 1, 2, ith, jth coordinate, etc. So there's a lot of subscripts and indices to keep track of. That's really the hardest thing about sequences of vectors is the notation. This result is extremely easy to believe as soon as you read it, but I will give you the proof. And that is that sequences of vectors converge in Rn if and only if their individual coordinates converge. So if we're looking at a sequence of vectors in R3, you would need the x coordinates to converge, the y coordinates to converge, and the z coordinates to converge. It's not that hard to believe. In fact, I think we can prove it as like a chain of if and only if statements. Notice, let's see what we have here. Sequence, how am I denoting these? V sub k converges to the limit, which is going to be a vector in its own right. If and only if, let me recall that statement I made when we were talking about the notion of sequential convergence, and that was that sequences converge if the distance from the sequence terms to the limits converges to zero. So if and only if the distance from the sequence terms to the limit, this distance measurement here converges to zero. But here we're working in the Euclidean space Rn. We actually have distance formula. So this is if and only if the square root of v sub k comma 1 minus v1, where there I mean the first coordinate of the limit vector, all the way through v sub k comma n minus v sub n. So this is literally the distance. You need that to go to zero. Algebraically, this square rooted expression is going to go to zero if and only if each of these individual non-negative pieces goes to zero. So let's say v sub k comma I minus v sub I goes to zero for all indices I. We're basically done here, but this is like not exactly the final form. So let me say, and that happens if and only if v sub k comma I converges to vi. Not at all surprising, but here is a proof. I think we can wrap this up here. I want to show you just a couple of results about sequences of vectors in Rn, but I won't prove them. Let's wrap up this lesson with just a quick look at these algebraic limit statements for sequences of vectors in Rn. The first one says that if vk converges to v and wk converges to w, then the new sequence you would get by adding vk to wk for each index k converges as expected to v plus w. So in other words, the limit of the sum is the sum of the limits. For the second one, what we have here is a sequence of scalars, which converges to, say, the real number lambda, and then a sequence of vectors, v sub k, converging to v. Then the product of these two convergent sequences converges to their product, where here by product, we mean a scalar times a vector. So basically, this says that if you're working with nice convergent sequences, you can do like algebraic combinations of those convergent sequences. And I don't think it's worth spending too much more time on this because you probably did a lot of this in detail on R, and it's very similar here because as we just examined, when you're looking at a sequence of vectors, you can essentially go down to the level of looking at their individual coordinates, and then their coordinates are sequences of real numbers. Okay, we have another lesson to talk about with sequences, and then we will kind of use sequences for a while. So sequences give us tools with which we can examine, say, the notion of being a closed set, or once we've defined what this means, the notion of being a compact set. Thank you for your attention.